but I'm focusing mainly on the new ISO top-level ontology standard, which is a standard created jointly by ISO and the International Electrotechnical Commission under their Information Technology Committee. And it's in several parts, of which two parts have already been approved and are in the publication stage. The first part is about the requirements for being what we call a top-level ontology. The idea is that a top-level ontology should be domain neutral. That is to say, it should apply to all domains without restriction. And the underlying approach here is based upon the experience with building on modular ontology suites, of which there are some couple of dozen in existence, not all of which are successful. So some of them died because no one was using them, but there are some successful examples of ontology suites. And they have this structure. They have a domain-neutral top-level ontology hub, and then they have spokes descending from this hub, and then they have spokes descending from these spokes. And the idea is that because they all share a common hub, they have a common starting point for definitions using very general words like object or process or part of or is up and so forth. So W3C did not mandate a top-level ontology, and this means that W3C ontologies like these two have different top-level terms. So the provenance ontology has these top-level terms, and the semantic sensor network ontology has these top-level terms, and this means that people using these two ontologies are in effect working in different worlds. There's no way in which their data can talk to each other without significant manual effort. And so this is designed to resolve that problem. The definition of ontology in ISO 21838 part one is designed to be neutral as between two groups of ontologies. One group are the W3C type ontologies, which are built using OWL, and the other are the large number of biomedical ontologies, which were initially not built using OWL. They've been re-engineered to be OWL conformant, but their approach was quite different. And the idea of this standard is that it should be neutral as between these two approaches. So an ontology is a collection of terms, relational expressions, and natural language definitions, together with, and this is where the OWL issue comes in, one or more formal theories designed to capture as closely as we can the definitions. So the idea is that ontologies should be useful not only for computers, but also for human beings. And a top-level ontology, as I said, is domain neutral. This means that the only classes or types or nodes within the ontology graph in a top-level ontology are such that they can be reused across many different domains, ideally across all domains. So they are domain neutral. And a top-level ontology consists only of domain neutral terms, and therefore anybody can use it to define more specific domain-specific terms. And so the rules or the requirements specified in part one of the standard are that the ontology should be a pure top-level ontology and that it should be maximally general. And then there's a question, how do we test conformity to the requirement of maximal generality? And the answer is that we created a collection of 15 axes along which data are collected in domain ontology efforts. And we specified that to prove domain neutrality, a candidate top-level ontology has to show how it will deal with data along all of these axes, either by having corresponding terms, such as terms for spatial or temporal regions itself, or by having evidence that there is a strategy for defining terms relating to these axes already built in within the ontology. And there are further requirements. So the ontology should be available as a textual artifact, and it should be available in OWL, and it should be available in one or other common logic formalization, such as CLIF or first order logic. And then we want a proof of consistency for the common logic axiomatization, which is very hard to do. And we need a proof of derivability of the OWL axiomatization from the common logic axiomatization. So part two has already been approved. This is Basic Formal Ontology. I was the editor of this part. It is in the publication stage. You can already access the software content on the ISO standards maintenance portal here. And then there is a part three, which is still under a process of verification, which is DOLCE. And we have part four, which is a new ontology effort coming out of Michael Gruninger's lab in Toronto, which is a top-level ontology, which is focused more on what we might call a mathematical approach to ontology. So we have the hub-and-spokes approach. I personally believe that we should all use the same hub, but the OntoCommons effort is attempting to create a way of using both BFO and DOLCE through some sort of merger. The people who wrote this paper point out that the only top-level ontology which is used significantly in the linked open data cloud so far is BFO. And that's primarily because BFO was used in the biomedical domain. And you can see here some examples of ontologies which use BFO. And the biomedical domain is the domain which is most heavily dealt with on the linked open data cloud. So you can see the biomedical is the red stuff down at the bottom, and it's very black. Black means a lot of links. And when you move outwards, you find fewer and fewer links. So we worked very hard in the biomedical domain to create many links between ontologies. And a lot of that work consisted in using BFO as the top level, since we decided very early on that we wanted the hub and spokes suite approach, and then we needed a hub. And BFO was in fact developed as part of the OBO Foundry effort. But in the last couple of years, there have been more and more people using BFO also in other areas. And since Sam has already addressed the industry area, I will go through this rather quickly. And I'll just mention in passing that BFO is now being used as part of the JAIC, the Joint Artificial Intelligence Center, effort to create data for machine learning, which is ontology-based in such a way as to increase the degree to which the data that you have for machine learning will be able to serve as representative sample sets. And that's a very interesting side application, which may become more important in other areas at a later stage. ISO 12821838 is already having an impact in other standards efforts. So there is particularly an ad hoc working group on mid-level ontologies. And Sam talked about the IOF core. The IOF core is a mid-level ontology, which is designed to serve as the starting point for all Industrial Ontologies Foundry ontology at lower levels. So this is the IOF. There is an IOF maintenance ontology, which is documented here. There is an IOF, a rather large collection now of IOF ontologies relating to additive manufacturing or 3D printing. And some of these are documented in this paper. There is a simulation ontology, which is developed within the IOF initiative on the basis of BFO once again. And then there is a whole suite of other initiatives. So some of these are within the IOF approach. Some of these are preliminary to development of ontologies within IOF. These are examples within the publications of 2021. There are many more such papers in 2019 and 2020. So there is a lot of activity in engineering now using BFO as the top level I'm hoping that the one result of this meeting will be that the visibility of these efforts will be increased. And I should just mention that as far as we understand it, so we don't have a legal document specifying this yet, but our understanding is that ISO 21838 will be open source. So it will not be a standard that you have to pay for. It will be a standard that anyone can download as many times as they like. But you can already download all of the software relevant to 21838 Part 2.